As warnings about the risks of a changing climate mount, coming from governments, economists, and of course scientists, the urgency of what to do about it rises as well. How can we stop it, or better yet, turn back the clock on it? Katharine Wilkinson gave the keynote address at the opening of the Waterloo Global Science Initiative's Summit on the UN Sustainable Development Goals, and she offered some hopeful words on the fight against climate change. She is a senior writer at the Global Climate Initiative Project Drawdown and a contributor to the book Drawdown, the most comprehensive plan ever proposed to reverse global warming. And Katharine Wilkinson joins us now for more. So nice to have you all the way up here from Atlanta, Georgia.
Really nice to be here. Thank you for getting rid of some of the snow before.
Oh, we did that just in time, eh? Yeah. just this past weekend, just for you. What is Project Drawdown?
Project Drawdown is a nonprofit that is based out in Sausalito, California, and we do some of the most comprehensive research and communication of the world's landscape of climate solutions. We're also a book, a New York Times bestseller that came out about a year ago. But probably most importantly, Drawdown lowercase d means, in terms of climate, the point in time at which greenhouse gases in the atmosphere peak in their quantity and then begin to decline on a year-to-year basis. So really our work is about putting forward this important goal for humanity and the tools that we have in our toolbox to get there.
When is the drawdown moment?
Well, we hope it's sooner rather than later.
Right.
The work that we've done shows we can get to drawdown before the middle of the century.
Is that enough time?
These are the big questions. Mm-hmm. We're hitting some unexpected impacts like we've seen this winter in the Arctic. You know, we're constantly sort of assessing where we are vis-a-vis what models predicted. Ideally, we get to draw down sooner than 2050.
Mm-hmm. You know, we've actually talked to a number of climate scientists and activists on this program who are, never mind down about things, they may actually be clinically depressed about the way things are in the world today and about our ability to conquer these challenges. Yeah. Are you?
So it's hard to look at the science of where we already are on climate and where we are headed on our current trajectories and not feel a sense of despair. I think if you don't feel some of that, you're not paying attention. At the same time, when you immerse in the world that we work in at Drawdown of collecting humanity's wisdom and the solutions, the technologies and practices that we already have in hand, we're already using that can address emissions, well, you get a real sense that there is a blueprint of possibility. Not based on technologies that we'll have someday, maybe, but things that we already have. They're already scaling, at least in some places, and indeed tapping into practices that may be actually quite ancient in some cases, but bringing those forward at much greater scale.
Well, let's not overdo this, but do you want me to call you an optimist?
I'm not a big fan of the terms optimism, pessimism, hope, not hope. I really like the word possibility, because I think at the end of the day, this is a story that we collectively will write as human beings. And, you know, sometimes people say, oh, Drawdown, it's so hopeful, it's so optimistic. Well, we didn't set out to do a hope project or an optimism project. We set out to do the math on the extant solutions that we have to address emissions and to see where that could take us. And the news is pretty good, and we have other solutions on the way. But at the end of the day, this is really a human story. And it's a question of how much we will step into our own agency to deliver on the blueprint of possibility.
Well, math involves numbers. And I guess one of the big numbers in Drawdown is the number 100, because you've got 100 solutions out there ready
to go.
Give us one solution in particular that you think is important for us to know this evening.
So the number three solution is reducing food waste. Probably not on most people's guess of what a top five or top 10 list to address climate change looks like. I think it's an exciting solution because it's something that anyone can impact immediately and at no cost. Food waste, about a third of the food that we produce around the world is not consumed.
Amazing.
And in regions of high income like ours, that's mostly waste by choice. So we reject ugly produce, we overserve, we overbuy. We actually have a lot of agency as individuals to address that challenge. It's also pretty easy from a policy perspective. So in France, for example, grocery stores cannot throw away edible food. So it ends up in the hands of people who need it. It's an opportunity for people to save money. It's an opportunity to address issues of food insecurity, lots of wins, as well as addressing emissions.
Where's refrigeration on your list?
Refrigeration, it's not so sexy, but it is the number one. So the Montreal Protocol, as folks will remember, led to the phase out of chlorofluorocarbons, CFCs, which were the dominant chemical refrigerant that we were using in our air conditioning systems, refrigerators, et cetera. HFCs, hydrofluorocarbons, came in as the dominant replacement chemical for CFCs. Great on the one hand, because they have almost no negative impact on the ozone layer, but they turn out to have the heat trapping potential 1,000 times or more as compared to carbon dioxide. So addressing one challenge inadvertently, dramatically adding to another. The good news is the world has actually come to an agreement back in October 2016 to amend the Montreal Protocol. So we will be phasing out the use of HFCs over the coming decades.
To be replaced with what?
To be replaced with, there are a whole variety of solutions coming into use. Actually, carbon dioxide itself turns out to be a useful refrigerant. Gas, water, there are systems that are using water, propane, some different options. But in the meantime, even as we head to phase out of HFCs, these things are everywhere, right? Every kitchen, every office space, every vehicle. So we have a huge opportunity to address leaks and especially disposal between now and the time that HFCs are history. What our work shows is that we could avoid about 90 gigatons of carbon dioxide equivalent in those fluorinated gases.
I don't know what a gigaton is, but it just sounds like a lot.
A gigaton is a lot. A gigaton is a billion tons.
Okay.
I usually, when I explain this to audiences, I use an image of cows because a cow weighs about a ton. So you can imagine a gigaton is about a billion cows worth. In this case, we're usually talking about carbon dioxide. For sort of a reference point, the world emitted about 36 gigatons of carbon dioxide in 2016. So about 36 billion cows.
So the upside of this is enormous.
Dioxide gas. The upside is enormous. Exactly.
In the book, you've got a section on cities and building with 14 solutions. And I wonder what is one that mayors and cities around the world ought to be doing but are not doing yet?
So from that particular sector, one that I just love, partially because it's beautiful, partially because it's relatively simple, are green roofs and cool roofs, which have an opportunity to dramatically cut energy use in the top floors of buildings. Green roofs also are an opportunity to add green space in urban areas where there may not be a lot of it or a lot of opportunity for it at ground level, but you can imagine what could happen in terms of livability and beauty if we have more green roofs on top of our buildings.
When you say green roofs, you mean just colored green?
I mean, this is a great question. So green roofs are literally living roofs. So they are roofs that have, maybe it's as simple as sort of a thin layer of soil and grasses, but they can also be, they can be food gardens. They can be more park-like in their design and execution. Cool roofs are light-colored roofs that have the benefit of reflecting sunlight back away from a building as opposed to dark-colored roofs, which are absorbing it. Probably in Canada, green roofs are a better move because they're going to be better for insulation. You may want some of that sunlight reaching the rooftop in winter.
But that doesn't sound that complicated. I mean, presumably, like a bylaw change at City Hall gets that done.
Yeah, pretty simple. And cool roofs, particularly in hotter climates, really obvious solutions. I also think mayors should be thinking more about food systems, right? So we think a lot about infrastructure in cities, but everyone in cities is eating, right? And the relationship between cities and the agricultural systems that support the people who live in cities are really important. I'm a big proponent of municipal composting solutions. So in San Francisco, for example, your trash gets picked up, your recycling gets picked up, but also your compost gets picked up. And we need to think about how to integrate that into cities where more and more people are living in condos and, right, and these sorts of living arrangements.
My hunch is people would look at the book and they would say, okay, energy and food, I get that chapter. Transportation and cities, I get that chapter. Cities and buildings, et cetera. There's a chapter on women and girls.
Yeah.
Why is that there?
So obviously all of the solutions in Drawdown are relevant to women and girls. Mm-hmm. And some of them, like clean cook stoves, will have a disproportionate benefit for women and girls who bear the detrimental health effects of dirty cook stoves. But this one section that we actually call women and girls is focused on three solutions that look at the securing or advancing of key rights and opportunities for women and girls that happen to have planetary ripple effects. So the number six and number seven solutions are very much tied together. Educating girls, which is closing the gap on universal education through secondary school, and family planning, which is about ensuring that women have access to high quality, voluntary, reproductive health care. So
I get why those are all urgent problems.
Yes.
What do they have to do with climate
change? So it turns out that with more years of education, women choose to have smaller families. We've seen this story unfold in North America. If you want to have a smaller family, you need some way to manage the size and spacing of your children. And so contraception and access to reproductive health care becomes really important. If you play out those choices across the globe, they will have everything to do with whether we land at the United Nations medium projection for our population size at mid-century or the high projection. If you have a billion or so fewer pairs of feet making their carbon footprints, that adds up, and that's why they make it into the book. But I think it's really important to emphasize that they are solutions that begin and end with rights that we should be pursuing on their own accord, and they just happen to have this additional benefit.
Understood. You've talked to us about smarter buildings. How about smarter highways? What does that involve?
Smarter highways. So I live in Atlanta, and if you can believe it, the sort of laboratory for the future of highways and making highways sustainable, right? This seems like an oxymoron, is happening south of our city. It's called the Ray, and they've taken an 18-mile stretch of highway, and they are testing all sorts of different opportunities to turn what may be one of the dirtiest aspects of our human infrastructure into something positive, into something that actually advances us towards Drawdown. So that's everything from roads that are actually solar panels. So you think about all of the space that asphalt takes up. Great opportunity for the sun's rays to be captured generate electricity.
Not made out of concrete or cement.
Solar panels. Yeah.
Cool.
There's a French company called Wattway. There's a cool photo in the book if you want to get a sense, and on our website, a sense of what this looks like. But they're also looking at the opportunity that comes with the areas of land on the sides of the road itself, right? Could that actually be used for regenerative agriculture, for example? Could you have opportunities to be advancing carbon sequestration in soil along our roads as well? So they're doing all sorts of interesting things.
Couple of minutes to go here, and I want to actually share a dirty little secret with you here,
okay,
which is that when we cover climate change on this program, our ratings go down.
Yeah.
Now, because we're public television, we can afford to have low ratings every now and then to cover subjects that we think are important. But the reality is there is a certain amount of doom and gloom that people have just apparently
said,
you know, enough already, we can't take any more of this. How do you get people to listen to this message?
Yeah, so I see the faces of some of those folks when I stand up to give talks, right? You can sort of see, particularly like maybe students who have been cajoled into attendance, it's like, oh, not another one of these. No, I think the sort of dominant narrative about climate change has been really disempowering. It has been sort of the science tells us it's bad, that it's going to get really bad, that we're headed towards a potentially unlivable planet, not super well equipped as a species to change course. So change your light bulbs, right? And cross your fingers that the powers that be in international negotiations or the halls of power or some geniuses in Silicon Valley will sort this out. Well, it's very hard to face this kind of dramatic existential threat and feel like you have no agency. And what I think is so powerful about our work at Drawdown is that when you look at this whole mosaic of climate solutions, it becomes really clear that there are footholds of action for every single individual and every single institution on the planet. And I think that's incredibly important. If you feel like there's nothing you can do, you're going to want to close your eyes, close your ears, and the ratings are going to drop. And I think that when we come in through the lens of solutions, we also start to see the many positive and nearer term benefits of pursuing these technologies and practices that may give people a reason to dig in that a long term existential threat doesn't do for them.
You, I presume, in your travels run into people who factually oppose the notion that the climate is changing. But then there is also this notion of an emotional denial of climate change as well.
Yeah.
Which do you think is more dangerous?
So I think anything that takes you out of the game is dangerous. We need every single individual and every single institution pulling together on this one.
There is
never
on deck, eh?
All hands on deck. There has never been more of a sense of we're all in this together, right? For better or for worse. And I think, yeah, anything that has you sitting on the sidelines, that's not a great situation. But if you know this is a challenge and you for some reason are not kind of emotionally engaged, it may be because you're coming at it from the lens of the problem statement instead of the lens of the solutions. And I would encourage people, if they know this is a problem but haven't gotten involved, to look at our website, flip through the book, think of it as a choose your own adventure story, right? So what's here? There's so much good work to do, but what's here that you're particularly excited about, that you have some fire in the belly for, and dig in there?
There's only 100 ideas to choose from, right?
Only 100, I know. It's a pretty slim pickings.
Got to be something there for everybody. That's Katharine Wilkinson, senior writer for Project Drawdown. And we're so grateful you spared some time for us at TVO tonight. Thank you.
Totally my pleasure.
The Agenda with Steve Bacon is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario, helping businesses stay on the right side of change with strategic thinking, insightful decisions, and business leadership. Are you on the right side of change? Ask an Ontario CPA.